God's people, those who were not my people, would be called my beloved. Text, Hebrews chapter 7 verses 1 to end. Then verily the first covenant had also ordinances of divine service, and a worldly sanctuary. For there was a tabernacle made, the first, wherein was the candlestick, and the table, and the shewbread, which is called the sanctuary. And after the second veil, the tabernacle which is called the holiest of all, which had the golden censer, and the ark of the covenant overlaid round about with gold, wherein was the golden pot that had manna, and Aaron's rod that budded, and the tables of the covenant, and over it the cherubims of glory shadowing the mercy seat, of which we cannot now speak particularly. Now, when these things were thus ordained, the priests went always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service of God. But into the second went the high priest alone once every year, not without blood, which he offered for himself, and for the errors of the people, the Holy Ghost this signifying, that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest, while, as the first tabernacle was yet standing, which was a figure for the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices, that could not make him that did the service perfect, as pertaining to the conscience, which stood only in meats and drinks, and divers washings, and carnal ordinances, imposed on them until the time of reformation. But Christ being come and high priest of good things to come, by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. For, if the blood of bulls and of goats, and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean, sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? And for this cause he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. For, where a testament is, there must also of necessity be the death of the testator. For a testament is of force, after men are dead, otherwise it is of no strength at all, while the testator liveth. Whereupon neither the first testament was dedicated without blood. For, when Moses had spoken every precept to all the people according to the law, he took the blood of calves and of goats, with water, and scarlet wool, and hyssop, and sprinkled both the book, and all the people, saying, This is the blood of the testament which God hath enjoined unto you. Moreover he sprinkled with blood both the tabernacle, and all the vessels of the ministry. And almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without shedding of blood is no remission. It was therefore necessary that the patterns of things in the heavens should be purified with these, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. For Christ is not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us, nor yet that he should offer himself often, as the high priest entereth into the holy place every year with blood of others, for then must he often have suffered, since the foundation of the world, but now once in the end of the world hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment, so Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. Hebrews chapter 7 verses 1 to 28. Brethren, all of you elected into brotherhood of the cross and star are very lucky people. You are not worthy of this kingdom, but it is according to the promise of God, as confirmed in Romans chapter 9 verses 25 and 26. Nor yet that he should offer himself often, as the high priest entereth into the holy place every year with blood of others, for then must he often have suffered, since the foundation of the world, but now once in the end of the world hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Romans chapter 9 verses 25 and 26. To whom does this passage refer? Does it refer to John the Baptist? If you say, it refers to John the Baptist, then you must first realize his father was a high priest, and his mother a devout servant of God. From his parentage, it is absolutely conclusive John was born into a priestly family. If you compare John's family background with the passage you have just read, would you say, it refers to John the Baptist? The Bible is more advanced than your knowledge can cope with. If I begin to expatiate upon and analyze one verse of the Bible, you will be mystified. But have you heard the prophecy of Hosea, as contained in Romans chapter 9 verses 25 and 26? Have you not heard what people say about brotherhood? They call Brotherhood of the Cross and Star the Church of Evildoers, the Church of Infidels, and that membership is drawn from persons who have never attended any church denomination. How many pastors and elders who withdrew from church denominations like the Roman Catholic, Presbyterian, Quaido, or Methodist, are here in Brotherhood? What has prevented these pastors and elders from joining Brotherhood? What has tied them down into these church denominations? If you were born to find your parents in a particular church denomination, would you have been able to break with the tradition of the family? If you did, would your parents take it kindly? You would find it difficult to set at naught what they believe to be important to them. Forever, they would want to belong to that particular denomination. Like a German historian philosopher said, he would be too old a dog to change his ways. Really, honestly speaking, it will not be easy for you to convince them to break with the family tradition. If your family had been a Presbyterian, say of Duketown Church, and your mother had been also a member of that church, and you were born into the Duketown Presbyterian Church, even if you leave Duketown for certain reasons, where else would you go? Would you not find your way into Big Quad, or Akin Quad, or Ifitaboa branches of the church? If you do not attend another branch of the Presbyterian Church, you will never say anything to tarnish the reputation of the church, you will never do anything to give the impression the Presbyterian Church was not a church denomination. Hebrews chapter 7 verses 11 to 14. If therefore perfection were by the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what further need was there that another priest should rise after the order of Melchizedek, and not be called after the order of Aaron? For the priesthood being changed, there is made of necessity a change also of the law. For he of whom these things are spoken pertaineth to another tribe, of which no man gave attendance at the altar. For it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which tribe Moses spake nothing concerning priesthood. Hebrews chapter 7 verses 11 to 14. Brethren, have you heard another important point? Have you heard the mysterious ways of God? It is said at the fullness of time, those who were not God's people, those who were not in any way known, will be called God's beloved people. It is clear from this, when the priesthood is changed, there must of necessity be a change in the law. The community into which our Lord Jesus Christ was born was not known beyond its horizon, and its citizens were heathens. They had never said, "God help me." They did not know anything about God. But our Lord Jesus Christ was selected out of it to fulfill the prophecy of Hosea, that those who were not my people would be called my beloved people. Compare these two situations, the pedigree of John the Baptist and that of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is said, when the priesthood is changed, the law must of necessity be changed also. The tribe from which our Lord Jesus Christ came was that of Judah, a notorious place, a deserted place unknown to any person, multiplied from a broken family. The citizens were not only heathenish and barbarous, but also superstitious. This was the very tribe from which our Lord Jesus Christ came. For you to know the significance of the voice of God, once God has spoken out anything, no matter how many years have elapsed, these words must actually be fulfilled. You will read Genesis chapter 49 verses 8 to 11. Judah, thou art he whom thy brethren shall praise, thy hand shall be in the neck of thine enemies, thy father's children shall bow down before thee. Judah is a lion's whelp, from the prey, my son, thou art gone up, he stooped down, he couched as a lion, and as an old lion, who shall rouse him up? The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh come, and unto him shall the gathering of the people be. Binding his bull unto the vine, and his ass's colt unto the choice vine, he washed his garments in wine, and his clothes in the blood of grapes. Genesis chapter 49 verses 8 to 11. You have been hearing the stories of Judah, as the tribe of thieves, swindlers, robbers. Achan, who stole the gold and silver vessels, being spoils of war, was from Judah. The stealing resulted in his destruction. All criminals came from Judah. Fornicators, rogues, swindlers and murderers came from that tribe. But can you observe the promise of God unto Judah? It is said the scepter will not depart from Judah. Judah, you will remember, had two children. The first son had a wife, but died without a child, leaving the wife behind. The father advised the second son to marry the woman in order to raise up children for the first son, that is, children who will stand in the place of the late father. The second son did not like the idea of marrying the dead brother's wife. It was because of fear he reluctantly accepted the father's advice. He was, however, intimate with the woman, but refused to ejaculate into her, because he did not wish the woman to conceive. For pouring away the semen, a practice which is very prevalent, and which you take as a simple thing, he died at that instant. Nowadays you want to be intimate with a girl, but because you do not wish her to conceive, you withdraw, and pour away the semen. See what can happen to you. There was in Israel at that time a very strong law against fornication, adultery and prostitution. Any woman who committed fornication, adultery, or who prostituted about had a death sentence pronounced on her. There was no pleading, but once a woman was caught prostituting, she was killed right there. Judah, the father of the two men, was a very sharp womanizer who never spared any woman who crossed his way. One day, as he was passing along the street, he sighted one beautiful woman, and so called at her house, to have an affair with her stealthily. Judah thought he would sneak in and out without notice, but after the affair, the woman said the only pledge for his action with her was for him to surrender his scepter to her. After some time it was reported to him that his late son's wife was pregnant. The news of her pregnancy spread like wildfire throughout the tribe. So when Judah himself had received the news, he approached her, and started interrogating the woman to find out who impregnated her. The woman simply went into her room, brought the scepter, and told him, it was the owner of the scepter who impregnated her. Judah himself was bamboozled having realized, he impregnated the woman. Since Judah was responsible for the pregnancy of this woman, that portion of the law was suspended on his own behalf. The woman was, therefore, spared. Again, when the children of Jacob made secret plans to do away with Joseph, Reuben, the first son who was intimate with his father's wife, and so defiled the father's bed, suggested he should be killed. But Judah, who loved money, made a counter suggestion that Joseph should rather be sold for money. They, therefore, sold him for 30 pieces of silver, and then sprinkled his coat with blood and took it to Jacob, and told him they found the coat of Joseph on the way, for maybe he was killed by a wild beast. Brethren, notice how destruction went into that family, and so the descendants became thieves, swindlers, murderers, and deceivers. Wherever you find rogues, thieves, swindlers, murderers, and cheats, know they descended from the tribe of Judah. It is said, your very brethren will be at your throat. Judas Iscariot, who betrayed our Lord Jesus Christ, was from the same tribe as our Lord Jesus Christ. Being the closest relation, he and our Lord Jesus Christ were from the tribe of Judah, but other disciples came from other tribes. That was why he was made the treasurer. He took custody of the disciples' property. They ate, slept, and conversed together, yet Judas betrayed him. This Judas Iscariot was a devil from the beginning. He did not learn his devilish plans, but was born with them. Our Lord Jesus Christ knew what sort of person Judas Iscariot was. Wherever there is a good thing, an evil thing will be found there also, to fulfill the prophecy which says when the fullness of time comes, the citizens who were not known and called his people, would be called the beloved children of God. To show you, our Lord Jesus Christ knew Judas Iscariot from the beginning. Read John chapter 6 verses 66 to 71. Then said Jesus unto the 12, will ye also go away? Then Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. And we believe and are sure that thou art that Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered them, have not I chosen you 12, and one of you is a devil? He spake of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, for he it was that should betray him, being one of the 12. John chapter 6 verses 66 to 71. Have you heard the reason why the Jews did not believe in our Lord Jesus Christ? They had searched the scriptures, the law and the prophets, but did not find where the scripture referred to a certain man from the tribe of Judah coming to reign. From that they concluded, Jesus could not be the Messiah. No person believed in him. Can you remember that always people ask you to tell them where in the Bible something is written about a lambrobu? If you search the scriptures properly, you will find Moses did not write about our Lord Jesus Christ. No other person wrote anything about our Lord Jesus Christ, but all of a sudden, somebody bolted from the blues. Would you have believed such a person? The case of John the Baptist can be easily explained. John the Baptist was from the tribe of Aaron, and from the beginning, that tribe was devoted to the work of God. Aaron himself was the first high priest. People were not surprised to see John preach repentance and forgiveness of sins. But the house of Judah, since God created them, had no connection with the work of God, and had never known about God. They had never discussed anything about God. But that was the tribe our Lord Jesus Christ came from. How would people believe in such a fellow, since none of his forefathers had been a priest? If he had descended from the priestly tribe, could he have been condemned by them? It is said, when the priesthood is changed, the law must of necessity be changed. Hebrews chapter 7 verse 12. If he had come from the priestly family, he would not have been able to effect any changes. He would have leaned on the old law. Since the priesthood was changed by his coming from another tribe, he was able to condemn the old law, and to institute a new order instead of continuing to rely on the old one. Have you seen why they did not believe in our Lord Jesus Christ? It was because neither his father nor his mother was a priest. People had searched the scriptures, and had not come across a passage which named the tribe of Judah as the house of the new king. As people continue to do today, they came out with the conclusion Christ was a mad fellow. If, however, they had read Romans chapter 9 verses 25 and 26, would they have persisted in their actions? To whom did this passage refer? How would the people believe in him? John the Baptist was born into a priestly family, and so the people believed in him, and regarded him as the Messiah. The father of John was a high priest, attending at sacrifices at the altar. He was regarded as the Christ, and that was why they sent people to ask him whether he was the Messiah to come, but he told them definitely that he was not. Notice how mysterious the word of God is. Who would have believed in the Lord Jesus Christ? If you were an Israelite, if you were a Jew living at that period of time, and had not known of any record in the laws or prophets which referred to our Lord Jesus Christ, or that a priest would come from the tribe of Judah, you would not have believed in the priesthood of Jesus Christ. That was how all of them failed, because they said no person should even listen to him. Brethren, the ways of God are incomprehensible. We here do not doubt the deity of our Lord Jesus Christ. But the Jews do not believe Jesus was the Son of God. They regard him as one of the prophets, but definitely not as the Son of God. They maintain, since he was a commoner from a heathenish tribe and from a family stricken with abject poverty, any person who proclaimed Jesus as the Son of God must be somebody who suffered from mental problems. That is why it is written in Hebrews chapter 13 verse 8, Jesus Christ the same yesterday, and today, and forever. What do you understand by that statement that Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today and forever? Yesterday he was born in a manger. He came from a heathenish family, the family from which no person from it had known anything about God. The tribe from which our Lord Jesus Christ came was not known, to fulfill what was written in Hosea, that at the fullness of time, those who were not his people would be called the beloved children of God, and those who did not know him would be made to know him. John chapter 1 verses 39 to 51. He saith unto them, Come and see. They came and saw where he dwelt, and abode with him that day, for it was about the tenth hour. One of the two which heard John speak, and followed him, was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first findeth his own brother Simon, and saith unto him, We have found the Messias, which is being interpreted, the Christ. And he brought him to Jesus. And when Jesus beheld him, he said, Thou art Simon the son of Jonah, thou shalt be called Cephas, which is by interpretation, a stone. The day following Jesus would go forth into Galilee, and findeth Philip, and saith unto him, Follow me. Now Philip was of Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip findeth Nathanael, and saith unto him, We have found him, of whom Moses in the law, and the prophets, did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. And Nathanael said unto him, Can there any good thing come out of Nazareth? Philip saith unto him, Come and see. Jesus saw Nathanael coming to him, and saith of him, Behold an Israelite indeed, in whom is no guile. Nathanael saith unto him, Whence knowest thou me? Jesus answered and said unto him, Before that Philip called thee, when thou wast under the fig tree, I saw thee. Nathanael answered and saith unto him, Rabbi, thou art the Son of God, thou art the King of Israel. Jesus answered and said unto him, Because I said unto thee, I saw thee under the fig tree, believest thou? thou shalt see greater things than these. And he saith unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto you, hereafter ye shall see heaven open, and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. John chapter 1 verses 39 to 51. Realize the reason why Nathanael asked that question, can anything good come from Nazareth? Take the Biakron community which you visit now every day, and go on pilgrimage yearly. The Ahathia people, the nearest neighbor to Biakron, regard the people of Biakron as infidels, heathens and as the most backward people in this country. The Ahathia people have no regard for the people of Biakron. If you pass through Ahathia to Biakron, the people will certainly ask why you should go to Biakron, and that you do not know where you are going to. They will do everything to discourage you from going to Biakron. No Ahathia man says anything good about Biakron. Consider this Biakron in another way. You can easily travel to Britain or America, Lagos or Port Harcourt, but Biakron, which is a few kilometers from Lagos, cannot be easily reached. There is no road to Biakron. People who travel to Biakron know what they suffer on the way before they get there. If you are to travel to Lagos, or even Kano, you can board a car and travel easily, but not so with Biakron. The Presbyterian Church first arrived in Biakron in 1919, but till today it has not improved. No Biakron man goes there, the people only stand afar off to see what the strangers, the teachers, do in the mission. Despite the revelation of the glory of God in Brotherhood, upon the singing, dancing, visions, miracles and the yearly visits of Brotherhood members to Biakron, how many Biakron people have you seen in Brotherhood? This is indicative of the true spirit of Biakron. It is a closed society, which does not believe in introducing any change in their tradition. 34 Ando Street, Calabria is always inundated with people who wish to see the Father and receive blessings from Him. But how many among them are from Biakron? Considering the above then, what type of tongue will you use to convince any person, especially Ahathia people, God has reincarnated in human form in Biakron? An Ahathia man would regard such a statement as erroneously uttered by one who has mental trouble. No Ahathia man will believe your story that Biakron is new city of God, the new Jerusalem. But he will believe, if you tell him, there is human meat, witchcraft, mermaid and concoctions in Biakron. But definitely, the true words of God cannot be found in Biakron, because, had God gone to Biakron, he would have passed through Ahathia, and they would have seen him. The Ahathia people will never believe why you always go to Biakron, for, to do the work of God, because the Presbyterian church which was taken to Biakron was carried from Ahathia, and so they cannot see why God has risen in Biakron, whereas Ahathia introduced the Christian religion to Biakron. They also believe people do not go to Biakron to do the work of God, that those who go, only go to be initiated into secret cults and societies, because they believe Biakron is the center for witchcraft, mermaid and concoctions. When you observe Biakron from the position of the riverside, you will realize the reason for the people's disregard for Biakron. All canoes traveling along the Cross River, between Ikepana and Abrakpa, were raided and ransacked by pirates from the Biakron people. All canoes were thoroughly searched and the merchants compelled to surrender their goods. Now, if you tell people who have passed through these experiences, God has reincarnated in Biakron, no person will believe your story, because to the people of the area, Biakron is always connected with evil rather than good. Even if you go to tell a Biakron man, leader Alambro Lambro Oduobu is the greatest religious teacher in the world, they will ask you where he had received his training as a priest, for he has never attended any seminary, Bible, or training college. His father did not attend any church, and neither did his mother. How is it possible for him to become a priest without any formal training? He himself never attended any church. He was a traitor. They will therefore conclude he is deceiving his followers. If they say this, they are correct, because I have never been a member of any church denomination, I was not baptized into any faith, and so it would not be easy for any person to believe your stories about me, in spite of the glory of God they have all witnessed. Brethren, have you seen why the people are sitting akindo and looking at you, as foolish men and women, being deceived? After considering these instances and comparing them with the narratives of our Lord Jesus Christ, to whom do you think the passage we read refers? It is said, at the fullness of time, the people who were not my people, I will call them my people, and that in a place where it was said unto them, You are not my people, there shall they be called the children of the living God, and those who were not beloved will be called my beloved children. See Romans chapter 9 verses 25 and 26. As he saith also in Ozi, I will call them my people, which were not my people, and her beloved, which was not beloved. And it shall come to pass, that in the place, where it was said unto them, Ye are not my people, there shall they be called the children of the living God. Romans chapter 9 verses 25 and 26. After reading through the passage, who in the world has been linked up to it? This is, why I tell you, the word of God is a two-edged sword. Any person who is faithful to God will certainly be shown the secret things of God. If I had been a member of any church denomination, I would have been tied to the apron strings of my church. I would not have found it easy to cut the strings in order to establish afresh. If I had been brought up in the strict Presbyterian way, I would have attended the Presbyterian school and Sunday school. I would have gone into the Presbyterian secondary school or the Presbyterian teachers training college, after which I would have been sent to Trinity College at Umeå to train as a minister of God. I would have held my allegiance to the Presbyterian Church. I would not have withdrawn from it. Under such a circumstance, it would not have been possible for me to resign from my post as a minister to establish a new faith. Many people would have become members of Brotherhood having seen the light, but they claim, since they come from a Presbyterian family, they cannot break the tradition of the family, and so must continue to hold the staff of office of the family in the church. I am telling you, they will perish with the staff of office. Our Lord Jesus Christ was not from a priestly family, but the scriptures were fulfilled in him. When the priesthood is changed, the law must accordingly be changed. Hebrews chapter 7 verse 12. He was specifically sent from that tribe in order to show the truth to the whole world. He did not take a cue from any other person. He was, therefore, free to install what people had not known before, and to become a prince of peace and priest forever. Read John chapter 7 verses 14 to 16. Now about the midst of the feast Jesus went up into the temple, and taught. And the Jews marveled, saying, How knoweth this man letters, having never learned? Jesus answered them, and said, My doctrine is not mine, but this that sent me. John chapter 7 verses 14 to 16. If you were told that leader Alambro Lambrogo is the sole spiritual head, you would not have believed, you would consider that being a traitor, he would not have had the time to train in the seminary or Bible college to become a powerful religious leader. Have you heard what is read in that passage? His fellow tribesmen asked him the question, From where has this man derived his knowledge? Where was he trained? Why did they ask him that question? When you shout on the name they look down upon you. Who is linked with the statement made in that passage? Today this same situation has repeated itself. People continue to speak evil of you and say you are enslaving yourself. Indeed, in spite of your high education, good parentage, and good upbringing, you allow yourself to be misled by an illiterate biathlon man. Many people continue to ask you, how many degrees has the leader of Brotherhood of the Cross and Star? If you say he has none, they will blame you for your foolishness in following him. That is what has deceived the people, but they forget about what was written in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verses 26 to 29. For ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble, are called, but God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty, and base things of the world, and things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and things which are not, to bring to naught things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verses 26 to 29. To whom does this passage refer? Is it not our Lord Jesus Christ? What was he? He was of poor parentage. His father Joseph was a poor carpenter, and his mother was regarded as a prostitute. He himself was poor. He never attended any school. He never came from the priestly family, but he was found in the temple discussing, arguing and teaching the lawyers. Was it not a surprising thing? People did not listen to him, because he was not born into the house of Herod, the king, neither was he a lawyer nor a doctor, nor a millionaire, nor a judge, nor from a priestly family, and so they felt he was a mentally deranged fellow. But brethren, see, how God can employ the foolish people of this world to confound the wisdom of the wise, and use the simple things to confound the great. Our Lord Jesus Christ was never born into a priestly family, nor a royal family, and he was not written about by Moses, and so they concluded, his followers were following the wrong horse. Since our Lord Jesus Christ was not a lawyer, engineer, doctor, or administrator, would it have been easy for lawyers, engineers, doctors and administrators to follow him? The carnal father of our Lord Jesus Christ was not a priest, and his mother was not seriously devoted to the work of God. Will you say, it would be simple for high priests to accept and follow him? Have you seen how God has used things which are non-existent to disgrace the mighty things of this world? Even though the Jews were trying to persuade the people not to follow him, he had become so wise and intelligent he now leads the world. Now read, John chapter 10 verses 17 to 21. Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life, that I might take it again. No man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received of my Father. There was a division therefore again among the Jews for these sayings. And many of them said, He hath a devil, and is mad, why hear ye him? Others said, These are not the words of him that hath a devil. Can a devil open the eyes of the blind? John chapter 10 verses 17 to 21. Notice what was obtaining at the time of our Lord Jesus Christ. Today many people are shouting Jesus, Jesus. But have you heard how people treated him at his time? He was regarded as a demon, a senseless man, a mentally deranged fellow. The above passage refers to a particular individual. Have you heard the words of God? Some people said our Lord Jesus Christ was a madman, others said he had a demon, but others still said a demon-possessed person could not open the eyes of a blind man. There was a division amongst them. If our Lord Jesus Christ had been the son of King Herod or the son of the high priest, Zacharias or of a lawyer or any other distinguished person, would they have had the guts to speak to him in that way? This is because people did not know him, but God used what was not in existence to confound the mighty things, because they considered, since Christ did not come from a priestly family or from a royal family, he was not considered capable of ruling over them. That was why, when he was declared King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the people rent their garments, and said he would only reign over their dead bodies. Those who belonged to the priesthood also conspired against him, saying, This man who is not from a priestly line is coming to disgrace the high office of the priesthood, if he is allowed. He would set at naught the long-standing tradition of priesthood. Those from the royal family, on their own part of the conspiracy thought, since Christ was never from the royal family, he was coming to usurp the kingship from them, and the members of the royal family plotted to get rid of him. The lawyers on their part also plotted against his existence. So all and sundry teamed up to have him destroyed, because he was coming to usurp their positions, otherwise he would superimpose his new teachings on them. His strange teachings about a strange God were different from the type of teachings they were used to, because, when the priesthood is changed, the law is changed accordingly. They considered, their folly and emptiness would be exposed. Brethren, when you were in the various church denominations, your eyes were not opened. But now, how have you found yourself? This is why the various church denominations have teamed up to fight against what they call strange teachings about a strange God, and these strange teachings have exposed them to ridicule, and they are fighting tooth and nail to destroy brotherhood, but can they do it? We do not preach Presbyterian, Mount Zion, Apostolic, we preach Christ and Jehovah God. That is why the world has been put to shame, but I am not under them, because when the priesthood is changed, the law has to be changed with it. I do not know them, they can break their necks, but I shall continue to preach Christ as God. I am only preaching Christ and the truth. Which bishop will ever call me his colleague? Which university man will say I attended school with him? Which university will ever call me an old student, and which archbishop will claim I was brought up under him? Who would call me his equal? No person can say hello. I preach the truth and point out their faults to them. Are they not using the same Bible we are using? Have they been seeing what we are seeing in it? Yet, they say brotherhood is using a different Bible, when you point out their faults to them. John chapter 10 verses 11 to 13. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. But he that is an hireling, and not the shepherd, whose own the sheep are not, seeth the wolf coming, and leaveth the sheep, and fleeth, and the wolf catcheth them, and scattereth the sheep. The hireling fleeth, because he is an hireling, and careth not for the sheep. John chapter 10 verses 11 to 13. The bishops, who are they, and who struggle over the church property, are they the workers of God or are they hirelings? Who amongst them serves God free of charge? That is not the work of God, if they are working for money. Even if they are paid a kobo, or a naira, they are hirelings. If you call yourself a bishop, a pastor, an evangelist and you receive salaries and wages, you are not different from civil servants, who work for the government and are paid monthly. You are, therefore, not serving God. How much was paid to our Lord Jesus Christ? What about the disciples and the apostles, how much were they paid? But these church people who are paid, claim they serve God. They complain, leader Alambro Lambrogu has come to cause difficulties. But our Lord Jesus Christ, Paul and Barnabas served without asking any person for any pay. The work of God is the work of love. 1 Corinthians chapter 9 verses 15 to 19. But I have used none of these things, neither have I written these things, that it should be so done unto me, for it were better for me to die, than that any man should make my glorying void. For, though I preach the gospel, I have nothing to glory of, for necessity is laid upon me, yea, woe is unto me, if I preach not the gospel. For, if I do this thing willingly, I have a reward, but if against my will, a dispensation of the gospel is committed unto me. What is my reward then? Verily that, when I preach the gospel, I may make the gospel of Christ without charge, that I abuse not my power in the gospel. For, though I be free from all men, yet have I made myself servant unto all, that I might gain the more. 1 Corinthians chapter 9 verses 15 to 19. Brethren, if you claim your father was a preacher, was he not paid salaries? He was not serving God, but his own belly. Which church denomination in Nigeria, in Africa, or in the whole world will boast it is serving God? Which God? There is no bishop or pastor who can't stand before me in things of God, because he is a rogue, he is a thief, he is a swindler. I have not described them as such, but it is our Lord Jesus Christ who in John chapter 10 verse 1 described them as thieves and robbers. John chapter 10 verses 1 and 2. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, the same is a thief and a robber. But he that entereth in by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. John chapter 10 verses 1 and 2. The churches have not complied with these instructions. They are angry, they are fed up with the position of their church. Is this the time for annoyance? Have you people seen the testimony in which 13 different churches including their dignitaries conspired to run down and tarnish the image of brotherhood? They have mounted and sponsored campaigns against brotherhood. The bishops and pastors of various denominations have met several times to discuss how they will destroy brotherhood, because, if it is allowed to continue to spread like wildfire, their very existence would soon be determined and all their members would be absorbed by brotherhood and their churches will remain empty. Notice the attitude of brotherhood. That conspiracy has not been published in any news media, be it electronic or press. But if brotherhood were to be involved, it would have been published. Is that the work of God? John chapter 10 verses 7 and 8. Then said Jesus unto them again, Verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. All that ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. John chapter 10 verses 7 and 8. Have you heard that? Upon all their preaching, have people heard? They cannot be heard, because they are thieves and robbers. The church dignitaries have seen their relative positions, and are now praying God and Jesus should kill leader Obu for misleading his children, and for withdrawing all their members into his own fold. Brethren, this is the time of handing over of churches to the correct shepherd. Right now somebody from Ahoga in River State of Nigeria has handed over his church to the Father. The same is true of a woman in Onitsha who had her church. She has handed it over. Church owners in Ivory Coast, Ghana and Liberia have formally handed over their churches to brotherhood. What else will they do, since their members do not hear them again? Before the civil war in Nigeria, a brotherhood outside this fold testified, if the sole spiritual head went out to preach, all the churches would close down. This is true. If I should decide to go out now, the police would not be able to control traffic. Many people would come out to catch a glimpse of the leader. The whole town would shake. But I will not go out to any place to avoid trouble. If the father were to move to Oran, there would be a lot of commotion from all sections of the society. The police would go to see him, if only to know him. Others would want to catch a glimpse of him. The brotherhood members in Kalibur, Adakpani and Akanput would want to move with him to Oran in case he does not return to Kalibur. People from the mainland part of the state would come to Oran to know why the leader has decided to move to Oran. John chapter 10 verse 2-5. But he that entereth in by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the porter openeth, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calleth his own sheep by name, and letteth them out. And when he putteth forth his own sheep, he goeth before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. And a stranger will they not follow, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of strangers. John chapter 10 verse 2-5. The churches have devised all means to keep up the population of their churches. But members are fed up. No person is interested again, their members no longer know their voices. The churches which hitherto were not used to drumming have now started to use drums, timbrel, trumpet, psaltery and harp, string instruments, organs and cymbals to attract their backsliding members. But these people are no longer interested in sound instruments. They even serve communion at their members' residence. Still, they are not interested. People now prefer to attend Brotherhood of the Cross and Star. They also come to your house to try to persuade you not to continue here, and promise you several things, but you are not interested. They also complain bitterly about the highly educated men in Brotherhood, who allow themselves to be deceived by the leader. Hebrews chapter 7 verses 25 and 26. Wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. For such an high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, and defiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens, Hebrews chapter 7 verses 25 and 26. When you read, you will realize the churches are enemies of Christ, because they say, Christ is dead and gone, until he comes back. Does God die? Know ye not God never dies? That passage will confirm to you, Christ never dies, he continues to live forever. Read that passage again. Hebrews chapter 7 verses 25 and 26. Wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. For such an high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, and defiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens, Hebrews chapter 7 verses 25 and 26. When you go home, show the portion to the Pope, the Bishop and the so-called church dignitaries, who presume Christ has died, and can only be seen, when he comes back, that he is at the right hand of God in heaven. That passage confirms to you, Christ never dies but lives forever. Does it mean the churches have never read that passage, or they cannot interpret what is in that passage? It is said, he died and after 3 days, he rose again and showed himself to people for 50 days. This means, he died for 3 days only. Why do the churches say, he had died? Does it mean, when somebody dies and resurrects, he will die again? They are told he rose, and many saw him. When they are told the leader will not die, they are so angry they say, since Christ died, he will also die. I am asking you, is Christ dead? I have told you, he died for only 3 days, during which time he gained dominion over death in the heads, and collected all shaky things and cast them into the bottomless sea. Thereafter he resurrected, and now lives forever. He is now a living soul both in the flesh and in the spirit. He is very much in the world. He is now everywhere. He is in your house, he is here with you, you in the office, he is with you at the market, he is with you when in an airplane, he is with you in the darkest night. He is talking to you, he is discussing with you, he is in the prison or custody with you. He is carrying out his spiritual work every moment of the day. He, Christ, lives forever. If he were dead, would the world not perish? He is and making intercession for you. If he is God, are you saying, God dies? If he is the likeness of God, the Son of God, why do you say he died? He is a living God who does not die. It is the handiwork of the church denominations or the Antichrist, who spread false doctrine, who indoctrinated you, and who brainwashed you, Christ died. The Bible has confirmed, he is living, but the Satans are preaching he had died. Some people say now Jesus Christ has come back again. Where did he go to? He has always been with us. If a man is traveling to Port Harcourt, he can decide to travel by air. He will go to Calabar Airport, enters a plane which flies thousands of kilometers above sea level. The plane lands at Port Harcourt and he decides after transacting his business, to travel by road back to Calabar. Does it mean, since he travels by road he will not get back to Calabar? Does it mean he is still in the air? Will you continue to look at the sky to see when he will fly back in a plane? The man has traveled back to Calabar and is singing and dancing, eating and doing all sorts of things, but you are looking at the sky to see when he will fly back from Port Harcourt. Who would voluntarily die on behalf of the people, and then would leave the people behind on earth and go to stay in heaven? What is he there for? Why would he not come to stay and care for the people he redeemed? John chapter 14 verses 18 to 20. I will not leave you comfortless, I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more, but ye see me, because I live, ye shall live also. At that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you. John chapter 14 verses 18 to 20. Go out to the world and bring in people from all walks of life, bishops, pastors, civil servants, civil commissioners, company executives, business tycoons, the sick, the lame, the poor and all sorts of people to hear the word of God, even though they inadvertently believe that we in brotherhood do not use the same Bible as they do, and that you are being deceived. Yet we all are using the same Bible. They allege that brotherhood is witchcraft, it is a ghost or a mermaid, it is Beelzebub. Where did Christ go to? Who killed him? Up till today, many people in brotherhood still pray till Christ comes back again. They are looking at the sky to see when he will come back. Notice in that passage, when he says, I will not leave you comfortless, I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more, but ye see me, because I live, ye shall live also. At that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you. John chapter 14 verses 18 to 20. He has never left you an inch. He is before and behind you. He is all around you. Do you believe for 1980 years since Christ left you, he is in the sky? What is he doing there? Under whose care has he left you? Is he not a human being? Is God not a human being? How can he afford to desert you? He has not left you like sheep without a shepherd. Why should he not take care of you? Why should he not cater for you? Why should he not protect you? It is this mistaken belief that has led many to find protection in other means, as they say, heaven helps those who help themselves, and for that reason they become entangled in the work of darkness. What is called heaven? It is up there. It is a Hebrew language, the other division they call the earth. You pray our Father who is in heaven, why is he there? Have you not been told in the scriptures, heaven is the throne and earth is the footstool? This earth is where you walk on, dance on and do everything on. Now you have heard what he said before he was crucified, that he will not leave you comfortless, he will come back to you. He died for only 3 days. After that he rose again and has come back to you, as he promised, and ever since he returned to you, he has not gone anywhere. He is here with you conversing, eating and doing everything with you. The worldly people do not see him, but the children of God have always seen him. They have been seeing him from time immemorial in both the physical and spiritual forms. Let me confirm again, our Lord Jesus Christ is living with us. To make your assurance doubly sure, read Matthew chapter 28 verse 20. Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and, lo, I am with you alway, even unto the end of the world. Amen. I shall confirm again that statement. Read Hebrews chapter 1 verses 7 to 12. And of the angels he saith, who maketh his angels spirits, and his ministers a flame of fire. But unto the Son he saith, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever, a scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. Thou hast loved righteousness, and hated iniquity, therefore God, even thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. And thou, Lord, in the beginning hast laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the works of thine hands. They shall perish, but thou remainest, and they all shall wax old, as doth the garment, and as a vesture shalt thou fold them up, and they shall be changed, but thou art the same, and thy years shall not fail. Hebrews chapter 1 verses 7-12. Have you heard that lesson? I always tell you, I am not Jesus. There are no two Jesuses, there is only one. He does not die. He is here doing the work of love, interceding for us all. Let my blessing remain with you now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you, Father.